you. Amen. You make declarations to him and he will hear you. Amen. And because he will hear you, then you have to be ready to pay your vows. You will pay your vows. Amen. And then it comes to this declaration and says, you will also decree a thing and shall be established unto you. You will speak it forth and it will come to pass. It ends up by saying, so light will shine on your way. So even as we declare today, may the Lord bring these things to us. We will declare them all, then we will have time. If there is any one of those declarations that you want to put in your heart, we'll lift up our voice to the Lord and tell God, this is the desire of my heart in the name of the Lord. So you just listen as I decree. And I'm putting myself in your shoes. So I'm talking about you. I'm talking about myself. I am declaring. I declare and decree that no weapon formed against me and my household shall prosper in Jesus' name. Yeah. I declare and decree that I will not enter into any vehicle or building which is for destruction in Jesus' name. Yeah. I declare and decree that the fire of the Holy Ghost will consume all my stubborn problems in July in Jesus' name. Yeah. I declare and declare that promotion and progress and prosperity shall locate me in the month of July in the mighty name of Jesus. I declare and decree that all my expectations will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. I declare and decree that the blessing of the Lord will make me extremely rich with no sorrow added into it in Jesus' name. I declare and decree that the blood of Jesus will deliver and protect me and my family from all demonic attacks in the month of July in Jesus' name. I declare and decree that the shouts of victory, the shouts of celebration and joy shall be heard in the midst of my house daily in Jesus' name. I declare and decree that there is a wall of fire that surrounds me and my household in Jesus' name. Adonai, Jesus, my awesome miracle worker, hasten your word to perform awesome things for me in the month of July in Jesus' name. If there is any truth in any of those statements and declarations, lift up your hands and tell the Lord, God, bring out a pass. Bring out a pass. Let it happen. Let it happen. Let it happen. Let it happen. In Jesus' name, 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 let it happen. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, standing like that, I want you to welcome a servant of the Lord that is going to speak to us. None other than Mwashi O'Brien. Mwashi O'Brien. Make a few welcome.
Going lift up a shout of praise. Hallelujah. One of the things you have just declared is that we decree and declare that shouts of joy and celebration shall be heard in the midst of our home. Why not start now? Come on, lift up your voice.
Give you glory because our marriages have been strengthened. We give you glory.
Father, we give you praise, Master. We thank you that you would call us from far and wide. That wherever it is that we have been this week, you did not let us stay there, oh God, but that you drew us in from our jobs and our workplaces and our busy schedules, and you pulled us in. You called a special meeting for your children. Oh, we thank you that this to us is like when a father calls his children for a get-together, and we know that our Father is up to something. And this place is no exception, because you already have begun. Hearts are being revived already. Sicknesses are fleeing already. Distress is being removed in the name of the Lord. Emotional wounds are being healed. We thank you because you already are doing it. And we open our eyes to see what the King of Kings is doing in this place. Oh, we're so grateful that when you picked the people that will sit in this service today, you did not leave us out. Oh, we're so privileged, oh God. What a great honor to sit with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, we love you so much, Jesus. We ask that you will teach us to focus on you, to keep our eyes stayed on you, to keep our minds fixed on you, Jesus. Because you're so good. If there is anything you have planned to do with this meeting since the beginning of all time, let nothing stand in your way, Lord. Holy Spirit of God, we allow you to move uninhibited as you already are. Let nothing stand in your way. Bring down every barricade, destroy every barrier, demolish every wall in our minds and in our imaginations. Cause us to unlearn what the devil has whispered to our ears, and let our minds be stayed in you. You're welcome, Holy Spirit. This is your space. Do exactly as you will. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Come on, lift up our shout of praise.
Thank you.
He overcame once and for all. He beat death, hell, and the grave. Nothing is too difficult for him. You can trust our Father. Thank you, Jesus, that you answer us every time we call. Forgive us for the many times, Lord, that we are filled with worry and complain, oh God, and that we murmur instead of lifting up a song of praise to you. Thank you because you always answer. Thank you because you know us by name. Thank you because you see our hearts. This day, dear God, as we lift up our hands in this service, we want to say, we are weak, but you are strong. Hold our hands, Lord. Cleanse us and make us whole. And cause us to be displayed in you, Lord. We love you so much, Jesus. Oh, but we ask that you will teach us to love you. Teach us to love you. Let our eyes be open, oh God, that we will see the infinite love of our Father. How deep, how wide, how vast, how great beyond all measure. That the King of all the universe, the Creator of everything, will stop everything and just speak to us. We're so grateful, Jesus. Receive praise, receive glory, receive worship and honor. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. To be here today. We are so honored that the presence of God is here, not just because we can feel Him, but because we also have the assurance in His word where two or three are gathered in His name. He's right there. So Jesus is here whether you feel Him or not, whether you feel like it or not, whether you woke up mad at Him or not, or frustrated or angry, Jesus is here. Do you believe it?
Yes.
Do you believe it?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm honored to stand here today. Grateful that the Lord is doing a new thing in this place and that I am alive to be part of what God is doing in this side of the world or this side of heaven, as Pastor Ali says. My name is Brian Moshigadi. Brian is alive. Moshigadi has no end. I'm born again. I love Jesus. He's the solid rock of my salvation. He loved me before I even knew about Him. And that is what causes my heart to beat the more, because Jesus loves me. This I know. I cannot say much about how much I love Jesus because I fail so many times. But I can speak all day and all night for a week and so much more about how much Jesus loves me. Hallelujah. I believe that's a testimony of some of us in this house today. Amen. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to stand here. I honor Bishop Dr. Jimmy Kimani and Pastor Alice Kimani, who have been my spiritual parents since I was born and born again. And I honor God for them. You want to put your hands together, celebrate the servants of the Lord that are doing this to us. Come on, you can do better. Hallelujah. Amen. That is our covering in this place. Amen. And we celebrate the Lord. I have been a beneficiary of just knowing Bishop and Pastor Alice. There are places I go to, me me. You see the way you see me like this. Me. And people don't know me. But just because Bishop and Pastor Alice are my parents, just those have opened on their own accord. Time is not enough to start giving testimonies. But I am so, so grateful for them. Mom and Dad, I really honor you. God bless you. Amen. I have my mother in the house, who is also known as Mama Christine. They did not amend that name when I was born. Christine is the first one. But Mama Christine is seated right here. She's a woman I deeply honor and respect. Mama, I love you. I honor her for many things, but especially because she was the person that followed up the gift of God in me before I even knew I had it. She pushed it. She pushed it. She tortured it. She fanned it into flames. Sister, I don't know whether she's in the service or she's coming to that service. Yes. And Dante is over there. Boy, Dante. Come on, somebody. I'm celebrating them because these are the people that they tolerate me. They at your morning. Ule kwanza. Dante's mama great. I'm saying these are the people that bear with me. They bear whether they like it or not. They have to just be with me. They just have to see my face. They just have to laugh. They have to call me constantly. You guys don't have to call me constantly. But then, they must call me constantly. They know every time I'm traveling or going someplace and when I'm having a bad day. Do you guys have bad days? No? Do you guys ever have bad days? Or just, okay, fine. Me, I usually have bad days sometimes. But the Lord remains good even in those bad days. Amen. Alright, I want to go to the book of Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 to 27. We're going to read that in the New Living Translation. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 to 27 in the New Living Translation. We'll read it together. Let's go. In the New Living Translation. Great. 1, 2, 3. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Huh? Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. Look straight ahead. Fix your eyes on what lies before you. Mark out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the safe path. Don't get sidetracked. Keep your feet from following evil. Let's take that again. Don't get sidetracked.
Keep your feet from following evil.
Tell your neighbor, don't get sidetracked.
Don't get sidetracked.
Come on, tell them a bit more louder. Don't get sidetracked. The title of my message is Focus on Jesus. Focus on Jesus. Of course, there is no condemnation. At some point, if you feel like you want to call it whatever, you can call it whatever. The notebook is yours. The words are yours. Great, wonderful. If you want to write it in your mother tongue, there is no condemnation. In the Passion Translation, it says this. So above all things, guard the affections of your heart, the things your heart feels for, the affections of your heart, for they affect all that you are. Pay attention to the welfare of your innermost being, your mind, your body, your soul, your spirit. Pay attention to the welfare of your innermost being, for from there flows the wellspring of life. When you see someone having a bad day, the problem is not on the surface. It's not the clothes they're wearing. It's the things that are inside. Check yourself. Avoid dishonest speech and pretentious words. Be free from using perverse words, no matter what. Did you hear that? No matter what. Then verse 25 says, set your gaze on the path before you, with fixed purpose, looking straight ahead. Ignore life's distractions. Hallelujah. It says, ignore life's distractions. I don't know how many of you go through distractions sometimes. That you, this is where I wanted to be. But no, it's not happening. So many things have come up. You had already planned that you're taking this loan and you're going to use it to build a house. Then all of a sudden, something just happens and it requires all that money. And then all of a sudden, you just feel like, now there's no hope, like, the first thing for us as believers is that we blame God. Or not you guys? Okay, fine. Those are the believers. The thing that they do first is that they blame God. Think maybe prayers don't work. Maybe he will come when he comes. Maybe it's your pocket zuri. Maybe kuna tu shida. Those are distractions. And the truth is, life is going to happen. Even when you're doing nothing, you don't need to do anything for life to happen. When you wake up in the morning, you could sit on your bed the whole day. You do not stop life from happening. Yeah? life is still going to happen. So, and in life there are going to be distractions, there are going to be trials and challenges and things that will come at you. But the important thing we're being told there is to keep your eyes ignoring life's distractions. When Jesus speaks to the disciples, we shared this on Wednesday, he said that Jesus is speaking to the disciples and not the Pharisees. He's telling them, in this world, you will face tribulations. He's telling that to who? The disciples. If he was telling the Pharisees, it will be like there will be an altar call at the end. But if you repent, you will not face tribulations. But he doesn't say that. He says to the disciples, his followers, the people who are following him, that you will face tribulation. But don't focus on that distraction. Ignore that distraction. In other words, or instead, in the place of that distraction, be of good cheer. That's what he says, John 16:33. Because I have overcome the world. You have got to learn to ignore life's distractions. Because they will come. They will come. One has appeared. Bishop spoke somewhere last month? Yeah, last month in Nakuru. And he was talking about the doctrine of suffering. And he was giving the example that, you know, many times as believers, we feel like the presence of tribulation is the absence of God. Not true. There is a reason God is taking you through this thing. I was having a conversation with one of our young people this week, and we were saying, but you know, if God wanted to take this thing away now, he can do it like this. If he's not doing it, there has to be a reason. And that reason is a good reason. He says in the book of Jeremiah 29:11, which we all know, that for I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for good and not for evil. To get you to tomorrow, and after tomorrow, tomorrow's tomorrow. To give you a future and a hope. So I'm going nowhere. I'm going to be here for a long time until the purposes of God in my life are fulfilled. I am ignoring life's distractions. Hallelujah. So, if you're ignoring, you cannot just be ignoring life, taking it very literally. You're not just ignoring life and just looking, staring, gazing into space. No, you are shifting your eyes from something and looking, focusing on the other thing. So as you're ignoring life's distractions, you're refusing to be taken up by the things that are around you. You're focusing on Jesus. One as if you. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1, if you can look at that. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1. You are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses. This is coming just after the chapter of faith, Hebrews 11. It's talking about these heroes of faith and all that they did, and it's lined them out, all of them. It's a beautiful chapter. You need to look at it. Hebrews 11. Right. Then we meet again on Sunday. We're going to give you another one. Therefore, since you are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down. In other words, let us strip off every distraction. Because everything that calls you, it doesn't matter. By the way, it could be a good thing. You see, we think that the things that easily slow us down, every weight, we think that those are bad things. But let us draw attention to this story, the parable that Jesus gave, the parable of the banquet. And he says that there was a man that put together a great feast, and then he invited his friends. But his friends did not come. What were their excuses? One said, I have just bought a piece of land. I need to check it out. The other one said, I have just gotten oxen. I need to try them out. The other one said, I've just gotten married. I need to, you know, spend time with my wife. Those are not bad things. Are they bad things? Your husband, wife. See? It's a good thing. Mafuta. It's a good thing, yeah? A team of oxen is like, that was heavy machinery back in the day. That is a good thing, yes? So it's not, the weight that slows us down is not necessarily bad things. It is sometimes things that you need to deny yourself. You see, like we're going into the season of praying and fasting. We started today for the next 21 days that we're going to be praying together. Now, if you love food like me, that could easily be a distraction. Not that food is a distraction, please, that's, but it could easily be. The person that you love to spend time with the most could easily be a distraction from what it is that you're trying to pursue. What I'm trying to say is that it's not necessarily the bad things, because when you think about every weight that slows us down, I read a book and this person was saying that many times the things that draw us from God are not the sins, rather the very gifts of God. The things that he has given to us freely. that you're spending more time with your friends than you're spending time with God. Can I speak to the young people? Well, not these days, not only the young people, even the older generation is on social media. Yeah? We're spending more time. What do you do in the morning when you get up fast? Do you check your notifications?
Mm-hmm.
I see the world was burning the whole night and they're wondering, oh my gosh, where's our solution? Where will he get up? Hardly ever. But if you're spending time with other people instead of giving it to God, then those are distractions. So it continues to say in Hebrews chapter 11, let us strip off every weight, good or bad, that it slows us down. If it's slowing us down, it's weight. Especially the sin. Especially to mean that there is sin, but there is also another one. But especially the sin that so easily trips us up. Because the other distractions, especially the good things, they don't trip us up easily. And let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. Verse 2. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Realize we are shifting our gaze from this one distraction and shifting it to something else. Because the wizard who can zuzu kwa ufalme, unangalia tu hivi ndio unangalia ngapi. No, you're fixing, you're shifting your gaze from this thing to this thing. You're focusing on Jesus. To me, if you're not focusing on Jesus, you're focusing on distraction. Hallelujah. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus. This is the formula. This is how we do it. Keep your eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he's seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. It is like this is the CV of Jesus. It's telling him, you need to follow him, and this is why you need to follow him. This is what he accomplished. And because you also want to accomplish that, then you best fix your eyes on him. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Turn to your neighbor, tell them, focus on Jesus. Come on a bit louder, tell them, focus on Jesus. You have got to run hard. Every time in scripture that God is telling you to shift your gaze from something, he's teaching you what to shift your, what to focus your gaze on. Like for instance, when he says that resist the devil and he will flee from you in the book of James, but draw close to God and he will draw close to you. Assuming that this is the devil, this item, not the devil, but assuming this is the devil, okay? And assuming this is God, not God, but this is God, okay? So, and I am here. It says resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw close to God and he will draw close to you. Or the other way, you can put it however you want. You can start with drawing close to God and resisting the devil. Yeah? It's one and the same. So every time I am right here with the devil, I am away from God. Alright? But every time I am drawing close to God, I am resisting the devil. Do you see it? It's not like God is telling us that draw close to me, so I'm drawing close. Or he's saying, resist the devil. Let's start from here. Resist the devil. He's telling me, resist the devil. Then I resist the devil, and then I get to a place, an unknown place in the universe. I'm just silent and empty, and now I'm like, now I've resisted the devil. I don't know what to do. Then God appears, and he's like, my son, now draw close to me. Then I start going in a totally different direction. Draw close. No. Every time he tells us, resist, shift your gaze from this sin, from this thing that easily entangles you, he's telling you, focus on him. In other words, the more you focus on him, the more you're staying away from that thing, the more you're becoming like him, the more he's taking you into himself. A friend of mine was sharing this with me this week, Pastor Larry, and he was saying, it was the same example, and Jesus is the light of the world. He's ourselves. He's the way, the truth, and the light. So Jesus is here. The life and the light. Okay? So Jesus is right here. And he's shining light. And so when the farther away I am from Jesus, then the light is not consuming me. It is only taking a part of me. Okay? So there is a shadow in me that is full of darkness. And in Jesus there's no darkness. Tata. Because I am chilling with the devil, I'm hanging out with him. He's my pastor, he's my people, he's my cool flag. Okay? That's the devil, because I'm chilling. But the more I continue to draw close to God, his light continues to take over me. The more I go closer to him, there's no darkness in me. I have become like him. Now I can be able to say Colossians chapter 1 through to 3 in the Message version. Verse 3 says, because you have died with Christ, your life is now hid with Christ in God. One as a few. He says in verse 1 of the same Colossians, if we can go to that, Colossians chapter 1 verse 3. So if you're serious about living this in the message. So if you're serious about living this resurrection life,
Galatians 3, verse 1.
If you're serious about living this resurrection life, act like it. That's what he says. Act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. If you're serious about this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Focus on Jesus. Pursue the things over which he presides. There's no way you're going to pursue the things he presides over if you're not focusing on him. One as a few. Back some time back, I think last year, I went to a friend's road show with a couple of my friends. And the road show was in Odai. I had never been there before. I'd never gone to those sites, well, that place before. And so when we were coming back, it was a foreign route. It was nighttime, it was dark, and I wasn't familiar with that route. And so one of the people suggested, don't go the other route. Let's use this route that goes through Muranga and then takes you out into Kenora, I think, that back route, okay? Those guys that come from there and route. And so I had never used that route before. It was like 7 or 8 in the night. I didn't know that road, but I was the one driving. And so when we were coming, the person that was Uko, there was a lady that was driving ahead of us. And she said, I know the route. I said, oh great, to a quarter anymore. Now there was only one problem. Me, I didn't know the route at all. And how she knew the route very well. The problem is, she was a very fast driver. If you know me, you know I'm not a fast driver. Most times. So, this lady was driving and says, you know, I'm like, sasa, I'm a bigger. You don't even know whether the road is turning this way or this way. That's dark. You know that dark? Have you been to Meru? Driving from Meru in the night. It's very dark. There's no street lights for some stretches. It's very confusing. So you go slowly. And at a point when we caught up with her, I decided I'm not letting her out of my sight. So I put my slow driving in the back seat. I put on a new robe, all right? And I was going with her. Do you remember in the year of divine elevation at the Kesha when we were coming? I'm not justifying my first drive, okay? Just walk with me. In the year of divine elevation, when we were crossing into the new year, Bishop said that in this new year of divine elevation, God is doing a new thing. And so when you see him shift, follow him. Run after him. Do you guys remember that? If you see God has moved, please, run after him, because the design of God from the beginning of all time, from the examples that we have in the Bible, is that God never gave the end of it. He knows the end. Trust him. Hallelujah. He says to Abraham, get up and go to a place that I will show you. He doesn't tell you, get up and go to this coordinate, that's a longitude 10, 10 degrees, I don't know, 40 knots or whatever. He doesn't tell him that. Go in between the Safaricom shop of those days and whatever. He doesn't tell him that. He tells him, get up and go to a place that I will show you. In other words, I know the way. You've got to trust me. Keep walking with me. So if you lose sight of God, you're left hopeless. That's how we have so many people in the church today saying that, I'm hopeless, I'm lost, I don't know what to do with, I don't know what decision to make. If you just take a few more minutes and sit with Jesus and focus on him, because it means if you are not focusing on him, then you're focusing on some distraction. In him there's no darkness. Remember the example? His light has taken me over. Hallelujah. So back to my story. So we're going. I started pursuing. I didn't want to know where we are going. I just knew we are going home eventually. Okay? So we've come all the way. At some point, she then stopped and got into like a different place. And then I'm thinking, God, but what do I know? Maybe it's a shortcut, okay? So I followed. So I just followed and went in that exact direction. But I kept following, okay? In fact, even after we got to Thika, at Thika, I still did not stop pursuing. No. I kept going, following just like that. Because if I had trusted before and she had gotten me to this place, I could still keep trusting and she would get me to where we were going. Is it teach the exact same thing with our Lord and Savior? He tells us, pursue me, follow me, draw close to me. I know the way, I have a good plan for you. I know that which is good for you. If you focus on me, I will get you there. And most of us are living this life like we've been here before. And I said in the earlier service that some time back, Reverend Withy preached a message on going through the valley of Baca. And through the sermon, he kept insisting, we have not been this way before. We have not been this way before. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 13 going down in the message says, take up all the help you can get. It's talking about the full armor of God. Take all the help you can get. As believers, we refuse to take all the help we can get. We are living like we have ever lived before. Like we have been believers before. So you go, unatifanya magmesh. Magmesh is magmesh. You unatifanya unatua, you get to a fork in the road, then you're like, oh Jesus, how I need you with all my heart. Oh, so much I need you in my life. Then he comes and tells you, okay, take this road. And then you take it. Now when you go, barabara imekuwa straight. Sasa unamuacha, umetangulia, uliacha Mungu kule nyuma, unaenda wapi? Utafika tu, and then you'll have to go back. Pursue Jesus. To pursue means he's ahead of you. What does he mean? Let's stop acting like we know, like we've been living before, like we have been a Christian before. No, you've never lived this life before. But we know one that has lived this life before. Scripture says our high priest has been tested in every way, yet without sin. He has gone through it without sin. He has been tried in every way, yet without sin. Therefore, if I'm expected to be holy like he is, I need to focus on him. Then I can go through life also without sin. Focusing on him who knew what is supposed to be done. Not just because he read it in a good book, but because he was that good book personified. Hallelujah. Oh, if only we learned to focus on Jesus. If only we learned to trust him and to take him at his word. That was among the first hymns that I was taught by my mother growing up. Because she saw that I could sing even when I didn't know what singing was. So she forced us to sing hymns, forced me to sing hymns when we were traveling to visit my sister. And we kept repeating. It was good entertainment for the people in the vehicle. So we kept singing. It is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to fix your eyes on him. That's what your trust means. That ukiona ameingia hivi, hata kama unasikia ni kama hiyo thing ndio njia, ingia hiyo. Mkishafika dika na barabara inakaa ni kama iko sawa na unaijua bado unamwacha endelee kuongoza. Because you have not been this way before. This is one of my favorite things. One of my favorite things. That when Jesus was ascending to heaven, of all the things he could give the disciples, he did not give them land. He could have said, you can take that beachfront plot. Para kapara naum para mitapatio. Iyo ni ya Peter. Sawa? Arafu kuna ile plot iko pale kwa mrima pale overlooking. Alafu utaita Revival Hills. Then none of you know what was these homes, realtor, nini, companies in your account. They name their, like, sir, pale ingakua Beatitude View Hills Homes. Or something like that. The Sermon on the Mount or Mount Olives Residences. But he didn't give them that. Of the most exciting things for me as a young believer is that I find, Jesus said to the disciples, I will not leave you as orphans. I will give you the Holy Spirit to teach you all things, to remind you all things, to lead you into all truth, to comfort you, to guide you, because he knew he had lived this life for 30 plus years. He knew it was difficult living as a human being. Alone, it was impossible. But I still, it was so difficult. Even when he was full of the Holy Spirit, he still knelt down in the Garden of Gethsemane and he was asking, Lord, if you can, come. And he was with the Holy Spirit. He had been filled long before that with the Holy Spirit. But still, it was difficult. But he knew there's something worse than life being difficult. Life can be impossible. And life is impossible when you don't have the Holy Spirit. So he said, of all the things I will give you the Holy Spirit. Amen. To be your helper. Because you have not been this way before. The Holy Spirit will help you keep your gaze on me, will help you focus on me. Have you read the story of Peter in the book of Matthew chapter 14? When you go through the book of Matthew chapter 14, there's many stories inside there. There's a story of the feeding of the 5,000 also in Mark chapter 8. But Matthew chapter 14 captures this particular account. When Jesus, after the feeding of the 5,000, these people have just come from a crazy good revival. They have seen food. They have seen Jesus. Jesus, there's nothing as good as fellowship and swallowship. Isn't there? Even Jesus knew that. So he did send them away. He told them, we're going to feed them today. Tutapatia buffet. Tutapatia mkate na tutapatia samaki. So, great. So, Jesus has given them this meatloaf sandwich of fish and, unleavened bread. That was a specialty back in the day, okay. So, they have seen this, they have enjoyed, they have had fellowship with the Master. Many people have been healed. There's a feeding of 5,000, we read about it to this day. Then he tells them, go into the boat and go to the other side. And they go to the other side, and then they are caught up in a storm, okay? Now, as they are caught up in the storm, Jesus comes on over, walking to them. When he's coming, they are terrified, they are scared. And like, oh my gosh, it's a ghost. What me and you will do, okay? And so when he arrives to where they are, Peter says, if it really is you, bid me come, call me to yourself. Because Peter is the dead one. And so the Master says, all right, come. Because he never sends away somebody who is, going to him or asking for help. So what does he do? He just jumps out. And for the first time, there's this one more person in the whole world that's now walking on water. And he's walking and he's walking. And he's like, oh my gosh, can I get a selfie? On the water. But he was walking on the water. But then it records something in that book of Matthew chapter 14 and verse 30 that then he looked down. If you read it in the message, it says, then he looked down and he saw the waves that were around him. And he started to sink. And he cried out, Master, save me. When he looked down at the waves, instead of looking up at Jesus, remember what Proverbs said? When he started to focus on the distraction. Oh, man, I wish Peter continued to walk, because the waves didn't start when he was walking on the water. The waves were still there. But he had managed to walk. I don't know how long he had been walking before he started looking down. But he had managed to walk on the same storms. These distractions will always be there. They were there in the time of Jesus. But he overcame them. And if you look to him, you can overcome them too. Oh, we have got to act like we know. And God has said to us right here in service in his own live voice that he is handling things only. We can trust him.